Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar AS Academy. Today we'll be discussing about Sammakka Saraka Jatra in Telangana. We'll discuss about oil seeds, decline in population of leopards, which are Schedule 1 animal in India. Then we'll also see the impacts of removal of dividend distribution tax on high net worth individuals and big investors or shareholders. We'll also see an article with respect to cyber security incident related to sale of credit card and debit card details of Indians in dark web in the internet. These topics we'll be discussing as part of analysis of the displayed news articles. The link for the handwritten notes in the PDF format and the timestamping of the discussed articles are provided in the description box, and they are also provided in the comment section for the benefit of mobile phone viewers. Now let's move on to the analysis of the state festival of Telangana. This news article is about a festival celebrated by tribal communities in the state of Telangana. This festival is called as Sammakka Saraka Jatra. Know that this festival is a state festival of Telangana. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. See, this festival is also known as Medaram Jatra. Now, this Medaram is a village in Jai Shankar, Bhupal Palli district of state of Telangana. It is a remote village or hamlet in Itunagaram Wildlife Sanctuary in Telangana. This festival is about celebrating women, where they celebrate a mother and daughter who stood up against the rulers against an unjust law. The name of the mother is Sammakka and the name of the daughter is Saraka, or also sometimes reported as Saralamma. Once a little girl was playing with the tigers in 13th century, and this girl was spotted by Koya tribal community who was returning from a trip. The head of the troop saw this girl playing with tigers, and the head was inspired by her bravery and he adopted her and named her as Sammakka. Later, Sammakka married a headman of a neighboring tribal group and she had a daughter. This daughter is named as Saraka or Saralamma. The mother and daughter are special because they protested against Kakatiya kings who forced the tribal communities to pay taxes. And it is reported that both the women fought bravely against the king's men and reportedly lost their lives in the fight. So in remembrance of these two brave women, the Koya community, they have constructed a temple as a token of gratitude. And in remembrance of these women, annually, every year, Sammakka Saralamma Festival or Sammakka Saralamma Jatra is held in this temple in the village of Medaram in Telangana. In this festival, people from tribal communities, they offer jaggery to the goddesses who are Sammakka and Saralamma equal to their individual weight. This jaggery is to resemble bangaram or gold being offered to the goddesses. They also take a holy bath in Jampanna Vagu, which is a stream in a tributary of River Godavari. And this river was named after Jampanna. This Jampanna is a tribal warrior who died while fighting the army of Kakatiya kings. And government of Telangana reports that this festival, Sammakka Saralamma Jatra, has no Vedic or Brahmanic influence. And according to government of Telangana, this festival is held annually and at times also held in every 2 years. And many tribal devotees from states such as Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Orisha, Maharashtra, Karnataka and Jharkhand, they come here and celebrate this Jatra. And it is said that Medaram Jatra attracts the largest number of devotees in the country after Kumbh Mela. Around 1 crore people have gathered in the year 2018 for this festival. Therefore, it is considered as one of the largest tribal festivals in the world. Now coming to Kumbh Mela, see, Kumbh Mela is a religious festival in Hinduism that is celebrated for a period of 4 times in a total period of 12 years. The geographical location of Kumbh Mela is rotated among 4 locations, which are 4 pilgrimages on 4 sacred rivers. The locations are 1. Haridwar on the Ganges in Uttarakhand, then Ujjain on the Shipra River in Madhya Pradesh, then Nashik on the Godavari River in Maharashtra, then more importantly, Prayagraj at the confluence of Ganges, Yamuna and mythical Saraswati in the state of Uttar Pradesh. And recently we have also discussed about Nagoba Jatra, which is another festival celebrated by tribal communities in the state of Telangana. To know more about this Nagoba Jatra, we request you to refer to our 30th January Hindu News Analysis. The news article states that the governor of Telangana has said that tribal traditions has to be preserved and these traditions and customs should continue. And this festival is one of the important tribal festivals that remembers the bravery of women in our country. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this news article pertaining to Samakka Saralamma Jatra in the state of Telangana. Now let's move on to the analysis of next news article. This news article mentions the views expressed by the Director General of Indian Council of Agricultural Research on the growing demand for edible oils in our country. He stated that two things are necessary to meet the growing demand for edible oils. One is that we need to increase production and productivity of vegetable oils or edible oils in our country. On the other hand, control on consumption of edible oils is also required to the level of healthy extent. In this context, we'll see about vegetable oils, then the present status of edible oils, then also important programs or schemes that are initiated to reach the target of zero import bill of edible oils. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. First, let's see about vegetable oils. See, vegetable oils are a group of fats. These fats are derived from some seeds, some nuts, cereal grains, and also fruits, or even from some parts of plants. Some of these vegetable oils are suitable for human consumption. These oils are called as edible vegetable oils. And those oils which are not suitable for human consumption, they are called as non-edible vegetable oils. And also know that edible oil or fat can also be extracted from animals as well. Now let's see the present status of oil seeds in our country. See, India is one of the major oil seeds grower, and also at the same time, India is one of the major importers of edible oils. India's vegetable oil economy is ranked at fourth in the world after United States, China and Brazil. The value of oil seed accounts for 10% of all agricultural commodities, 13% of gross cropped area, and 3% of gross national product. And the agroecological conditions in our country is favorable for growing almost 9 annual oil seed crops. These 9 oil seeds crops, they include 7 edible oil seeds and 2 non-edible oil seeds. Coming to edible oil seeds, they are groundnut, rapeseed mustard, soya bean, sunflower, sesame, safflower and Niger. And castor and linseed, they come under the category of non-edible oil seeds. And the diverse agroecological conditions are favorable for growing these 9 annual oil seed crops. One thing we have to note that oil seeds cultivation in our country is being carried out in around some 27 million hectares or 2.7 crore hectares. Rather than the hectares, the most important number is 72% of oil seeds cultivation is confined to rain-fed farming. What we can say is oil seeds crops are mainly fed by monsoon. So if there is failure or fluctuations in monsoon, then it will directly affect the production of oil seeds. And during the last few years, it is observed that the domestic consumption of edible oils has increased substantially. And the present per capita consumption of edible oils is at around 18 kilogram for one person in 1 year. Now, if you see India's total edible oil demand, we can take the scenario in the financial year 2016. So the total oil demand in that year was 24 million tons. But we are unable to meet even half of the demand domestically. And of the 24 million tons, around 9 million tons was met from domestic production and 15 million tons was met from imports. So more than 60% of our edible oil demand is met from imports, and import of edible oil is more than the domestic production of edible oils. So there is no self-sufficiency with respect to meeting the total edible oil demand in our country. And coming to future projections, they are saying that the total edible oil requirement will be at 33.2 million tons by the year 2022, when India is to celebrate the 75th year of Indian independence. So by the year 2022, the per capita consumption is expected to become 22 kilogram per person a year from 18 kilogram per person per year in the present time. So to meet the increased consumption and also to reduce the import dependence, government is now deciding or aiming to meet at least 50% of demand from domestic sources by the year 2022. Now we'll see some of the important measures that are taken by Government of India to increase the production and productivity of oil seeds. One of the significant initiative, what we can say, is the Yellow Revolution. It was launched in 1986-87. The objective, to increase the production of oil seeds. And there is also a national mission on oil seeds and oil palm. This is also being implemented by Government of India to increase productivity and production of oil seeds. See, this is a centrally sponsored scheme launched in the year 2014-15. Launched by Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers. This is implemented on the basis of sharing of expenditure, where for general category of states, central government will contribute 60% of the expenditure, state government will share 40%, and 90:10 ratio for northeastern and Himalayan states. This is one of the reasons why we call this scheme as a centrally sponsored scheme. And since the financial year 2019, that is from 2018-2019, this mission has been subsumed under National Food Security Mission. So whatever interventions which are now made under this national mission of oil seeds and oil palm, they are now considered as subcomponents of National Food Security Mission. See, India is presently meeting 60% of its edible oil demand through imports, and substantial portion of our requirement of edible oil is met through import of palm oil from Indonesia and Malaysia. And India has also decided at the policy level to reduce the import oil bill. And therefore, recently on 8th January 2020, the Ministry of Commerce and Industry has issued a notification to impose restrictions on refined palm oil. If you see the notification, which is based on the Foreign Trade Development and Regulation Act of 1992, the import policy for refined bleached deodorized palm oil and refined bleached deodorized palm olein has been amended from free to restricted. So the revised policy with respect to these two items is restricted. And the Director General of Indian Council of Agricultural Research is suggesting that we also have to control or regulate the intake of edible oil, wherein he said that people have to reduce their edible oil intake by at least 6 kilograms, so that one side it will promote the health of individuals, on the other side it will also help us to reduce the import bill. So he's suggesting an oil intake, edible oil intake per person per year to the tune of around 12 kilograms. So these are some of the important information with reference to the analysis of this news article. We discussed about vegetable oils, then we saw about the present status of edible oils, we saw the demand of edible oil in our country, how we are meeting it, then we saw few important measures taken by government to reach the target of zero import bill of edible oils. Now let's move on to the analysis of next news article. This news article is about a recent assessment that was carried out by scientists from Center of Wildlife Studies and the Wildlife Institute of India. The study was with reference to the status of leopard population across Indian subcontinent. In the context of this analysis, we'll see a few important facts with respect to leopards, their geographical range, how this range has contracted into few pockets in the world in the present day context, and we'll also see some of the reasons for their decline in population and two or three suggestions to conserve the population of leopards in our country. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. Now, scientists from Wildlife Institute of India and Center for Wildlife Studies represented the research fraternity in this study from India, along with few other partners from United States of America. Now, we know that Wildlife Institute of India is an autonomous institution that comes under Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, which was established in the year 1982. While this is the case with respect to Wildlife Institute of India, the Center for Wildlife Studies is actually a non-profit trust that is based in Bengaluru in our country. It was established in the year 1984. It is an internationally recognized center of excellence in the area of wildlife research, wildlife policy, education and in-situ conservation. Now, this research is titled as Genetic Analysis Reveal Population Structure and Recent Decline in Leopards Across Indian Subcontinent. The research estimates that there is a strong decline in India's leopard population size. That is, over a period of 120 to 200 years, there is a loss of around 75 to 90% of the leopard population. Maybe we have at present just 10% of what was the population around some 100 years ago or around some 120 to 200 years ago. There are some specific reasons why there is such a catastrophic decline, and human beings are one of the very important factors. Before going into those reasons, we'll have a brief look into these leopards. See, these are most widely distributed and highly adaptable members of the family Felidae. Felidae is a part of carnivores. It consists of lions, tigers, jaguars, leopards, cheetahs, and even includes small animals such as domestic cats. Of these animals, leopard is the most widely distributed and highly adaptable animal. If you see the historical range, it spanned across sub-Saharan Africa, North Africa, Middle East, South Asia, Southeast Asia, and even till Russian forest. But if you presently see, most of the regions are marked red in color, that means in these places, leopard species have become extinct. And we have very small pockets here and there distributed where presently leopards reside. Oh, mainly the decline is because of human-induced factors, the man-animal conflict, poaching for the fur of leopard and also for bones of leopard, then habitat loss, and less availability of prey for leopard, which indicates drop in ecosystem services for the survivability of this animal, then wildlife trade and few other reasons. The main important reason with respect to Indian subcontinent, the main reasons pushing leopard population to smaller habitats in Indian subcontinent are poaching and man-animal conflict. Presently in India, they are estimating that there are around some approximately 8,000 leopards, to be specific 7,910. This estimate is based on forested habitats of 14 tiger inhabiting states in our country. Now we can almost come to some kind of correlation between the drop in numbers of leopards in Indian subcontinent and also at the global level with respect to the loss of geographical range of the survival ability of this animal. In Africa, over a period of last 100 to 200 years, this animal has lost its geographical habitat range to the tune of 48% to 67%. In Asia, it was around 83% to 87%, and it is no doubt that in the recent research, they are saying that there is around 75% to 90% of drop in population of leopards in last 120 to 200 years. With respect to decline in population of leopards in our country, the research paper classified the leopard population into four subpopulations on their genetic variations and also on their place of living. And the research noted that there is a strong decline in leopard population across all these four genetic subpopulations in these four regions. The regions are Western Ghats, semi-arid region of Deccan Plateau, then Shivalik region, then leopards in Tarai region. There is red spots in this map indicate the presence of leopard population in these four geographic regions. In Western Ghats, the decline in population was around 75% in last 120 to 200 years, whereas in other four regions, the decline is around 88 to 90%. One reason why in Western Ghats the decline is relatively less is because of contiguous forested landscape with multiple interconnected protected areas. And the paper also found that within the populations in these four areas, there is high genetic variation in this species. The research paper is saying the genetic variations are habitat driven because now that their habitats have contracted, there is a lack of movement between the regions, and therefore the genetic variations are based on the habitat differences where they survive in the biogeographic zones. So because of restricted gene flow among the species of four regions, and there is significant genetic variations within the species. Now with respect to the declining population of leopards, we can say two major suggestions. One is we require detailed landscape level ecological studies on leopard populations, because these studies will give major insight that will help us to conserve the declining leopard population. The news article also suggests an initiative similar to Project Tiger, specifically for leopards, to arrest the decline in leopard population and also for the conservation of these species. So these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article. Now coming to the protection status, leopards are protected under Schedule 1 of Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. In the red list of IUCN, they are now placed under vulnerable category since the year 2015-16. Earlier, they were under near threatened in 2008, and way back in 2002, it was classified under least concern. So within the last 20 years, the assessment has shown that these animals are vulnerable across the globe. And they are also protected under Appendix 1 of CITES Convention, which is the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species of Wild Fauna and Flora. With this, we come to the end of analysis of this news article. Now let's move on to the analysis of next news article. This news article is with respect to a recent announcement made in the Union Budget, that is about abolition of dividend distribution tax. We know that Union Budget for the financial year 2020-2021 has recommended to abolish dividend distribution tax. In the context of analysis of this news article, we'll discuss about dividend distribution tax. Then we'll also discuss few impacts of the recent announcement on high net worth individuals and big investors who are shareholders in various companies. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. See, when we say dividend distribution tax, it is the tax that will be paid by the company itself directly to the government. Therefore, this tax is also coming under direct tax. This is actually the tax that is paid on the amount that is declared, distributed, or paid by any company as dividends to the shareholders. And these dividends can be either from the profits of the current year or from the accumulated profits. And know that dividend distribution tax will be paid by the company in addition to the corporate tax that is paid by the company. And this dividend distribution tax is covered under Section 115 Capital O of Income Tax Act of 1961. At present, the rate of dividend distribution tax is 15%. In addition to this, there will be surcharge and cess on this dividend distribution tax. Here, surcharge refers to an additional tax that is levied on the amount of dividend distribution tax, and cess refers to a temporary tax that is levied for a particular purpose. So totally, the effective dividend distribution tax came at around 20%. That is 15% plus surcharge and cess. So this is the scenario at present. However, this will be changed with effect from April 1, 2020, as the union budget has proposed to abolish the dividend distribution tax. The proposal will be given effect by way of finance bill, which will be passed in the parliament. Now, the new taxation policy with respect to dividends is that the company will not be required to pay dividend distribution tax. Rather, those individuals, those shareholders who receive dividends, they have to pay the tax as part of their income tax. And the money accrued because of dividends will be calculated under the head income from other sources for the shareholder. And this income from other sources will be clubbed with total taxable income for the individual, and the individual will be paying tax to the government for the total taxable income. However, this varies with respect to income tax slab. So those shareholders who are in lower tax slabs, they will have to pay lower tax. Whereas investors or the shareholders who are in higher tax slabs, they will have to pay higher tax. Now, one main significance of this recent proposal or announcement is that now the companies are free from paying dividend distribution tax. This means that the money which hitherto went to the government of India as part of this tax will now be available at the hands of the companies. There are two positive consequences. This amount they may use for further investment in the businesses, or they may give more dividend to the shareholders. And it is a huge relief with respect to tax burden from the side of the companies. So this is one of the important reasons why it is said that the recent proposal on abolition of dividend distribution tax will make India an attractive destination for investment. So now companies are asked to pay corporate tax and not dividend distribution tax. Well, these are some of the benefits associated with the abolition of DDT. Market players and experts in these markets, they say that this framework will hurt big investors and high net worth individuals who earn more money by way of dividends from these companies by investing in these companies as shareholders. This is because the new taxation policy with respect to dividends will definitely benefit small investors, but no significant or remarkable benefit will accrue to big investors or high net worth individuals. This is because the dividends received from the companies will be now part of their taxable income, and for the total taxable income, they will pay income tax based on their income tax slab. That is, for example, if a person's income is between 5 lakh to 7.5 lakh, then the person will be required to pay income tax at 10%. Whereas if the income of the individual is rupees 15 lakh and above, then the particular individual has to pay income tax of 30%. So this is the reason why the news article states that the proposed framework will hurt the big investors or big shareholders or big promoters and high net worth individuals more than the benefits of the proposed framework. This could have implications because now the big investors and promoters may feel that a significant proportion of their money will go to the government as tax, and they may be hesitant to invest in a company by becoming a shareholder. And the new framework also means a shift of tax burden from the company to the investors. Earlier, individuals who receive dividend income in excess of 10 lakh, only they will be paying a dividend tax of 10%. Now this will be modified, and the new policy will be based on income tax slabs. So these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article. Further reforms or future reforms in this area will be in such a way like there will be different prescription of tax rate for the dividends collected from companies for individual shareholders that may be reduced in the future, maybe in next year's budget or so, so as to address the concerns of big promoters and shareholders. Now let's move on to the analysis of next news article. This news article is with reference to the news that sensitive credit and debit card details of Indians are available for sale in the dark web of the internet. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. The news article is based on the concerns raised by a Singapore-based cybersecurity company. The company states that a huge amount of sensitive data, those data that are details of credit cards and debit cards, are available for sale in the dark web of the internet. and more than 95% of those data are details of Indians. And these data includes card numbers, expiration dates, card verification value or card verification codes, and sometimes also includes the full name of cardholders, their email IDs, their phone numbers and even addresses. So this simply means almost all information about an individual is there for sale in the dark web. So such full package of an individual's identifiable information is called as fulls by the hackers. When we say dark web, this is almost around some 6% of the internet space, which is normally not accessible through search engines such as Google or Yahoo. What they are saying is that it requires a specific software to access this part of the internet. Most of the activities in this dark web are criminal in nature and are used by criminals for drug trafficking, arms trade, etc. The news article states that more than 4.6 lakh card payment details are up for sale on Joker Stash. Now, this Joker Stash is one of the large databases of stolen card details in the dark web. And they are saying that the value of this database in the dark web is around 30 crores. This news about the availability of Indian details in dark web has been already informed to the Indian Computer Emergency Response Team. See, this cert was in operation since 2004. It comes under Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology. It is the national nodal agency for responding to cyber security incidents. When it comes to responding to cyber security incidents, it is the national nodal agency. The functions of CERT were specifically added to the IT Act through Information Technology Amendment Act of 2008. Now, it includes collection, analysis and dissemination of information on cyber incidents, forecasting cyber security incidents and alerting about cyber security incidents. And functions include carrying out emergency measures for handling cyber security incidents and coordination of cyber incident response activities. And they also issue guidelines, advisories, vulnerability notes and information relating to security practices, procedures, prevention, response and reporting of cyber incidents. And recently we saw about National Critical Information Infrastructure Protection Center. See, this organization was created in 2014 under Section 70 Capital A of IT Act 2000. Now, this is designated as National Nodal Agency for all measures to protect the critical information infrastructure of the country. The news article states that the data of Indians are being compromised by the use of malicious softwares or malwares, also through phishing and by also using JS sniffers. In some cases, the data might have been stolen from offline point of sale machines as well. Now, malware is an umbrella term that describes any malicious program or software or code that is harmful to the systems. They are usually hostile and intrusive. That is, they seek to invade, damage and disable computer systems, networks, tablets, mobile devices. And they will take either partial or complete control of the device's operations. A computer virus, ransomware, spyware are all examples of malwares. One recent example of malware attack is Strandhog. Now, we know that Strandhog is a malware that is used to hijack applications in Android devices. We also been discussing about attack by using a spyware called as Pegasus. This Pegasus exploded a vulnerability in WhatsApp's video call feature. We also saw that the email accounts and also the passwords of email accounts of many government employees working in sensitive government establishments are also available in dark web. And these would have been obtained through the process of phishing, which is one of the oldest methods of cyber attack, where attacker gathers personal information using deceptive emails and websites. They will collect information through email, where they will act as imposters. They will say that we are collecting information from your bank, from your company, like that. And they may also send some attachments. When the users click the attachments, the account will get hacked. The another tool that is used to collect this credit card details or the debit card details is what called as JS sniffers or JavaScript sniffers. These are programs that are used to steal details or information from credit and debit cards. These details are stolen from e-commerce websites. These JS sniffers have become one of the important concern in the recent times when it comes to cybersecurity and theft of sensitive details of individuals. in civil services exam, you may get a question in prelims like the term JavaScript sniffers are recently in news. What does it refer to? Or what does the term strand hog refer to? Or Pegasus? Or overall, they may ask about cybersecurity in essay writing or in general studies paper 3 under the area awareness in the field of computers and basics of cybersecurity. So all these information and examples will help you to write a better answer. So these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article. Now we have come to the last session, the practice questions discussion session. The first question. Now this question is with reference to dividend distribution tax. Now they are asking, the abolition of dividend distribution tax is likely to result in which of the following? Drastic rise in FDI outflows, narrow the fiscal deficit, make India an attractive destination for investment, increase the level of income and employment. See, dividend distribution tax is a tax that is paid by the companies to the government on the dividends that are given to its shareholders. This tax is taxed at the rate of 15%. However, if you add the surcharges and cesses, it comes to an effective rate of around 20%. Recently, while presenting the budget for the financial year 2021, the Union Finance Minister has suggested removal of this dividend distribution tax. Therefore, because of the removal, the government will be losing around 25,000 crores revenue. So we cannot say there will be narrowing of fiscal deficit. Now, with India moving business friendly with respect to companies, there might be quite an increase in foreign investment, so there may not be drastic rise in FDI outflows. And there is not a strong correlation with respect to increasing the level of income and employment, though abolition of dividend distribution tax may result into increase in dividends of shareholders from companies. See, the main statement mentioned by the Union Finance Minister while announcing removal of dividend distribution tax is that it will make India an attractive destination for investment because companies are now not required to pay dividend distribution tax. So that money which hitherto was given to tax as government will now remain in the hands of companies. And with this, India will move with effect from April 1, 2020 into a classical system of dividend taxation where the companies will not be required to pay dividend distribution tax. The dividend shall be taxed only in the hands of recipients. And this income from other sources will be calculated under total taxable income of individual shareholders. So the correct answer for this question is option C, make India an attractive destination for investment. See this previously asked question in the year 2018. This question is with reference to edible oils. They have given two statements asking which of the statements are correct. First statement, the quantity of imported edible oils is more than the domestic production of edible oils in last 5 years. Now this statement is correct because in the recent years we are meeting the domestic demand for edible oils to the tune of around 60-70% by importing only. Domestic production usually meets around some 30% of domestic consumption requirement. So the first statement is correct. The second statement, government does not impose any customs duty on all the imported edible oils as a special case. This statement is wrong. This is because India imposed customs duty on various imported crude oil and also refined edible oils. And these duties are time and again revised and mostly increased to protect the interest of domestic farmers and processors. So the second statement is incorrect. In some way, you can logically arrive at eliminating the second statement because it states government does not impose any customs duty on all the imported edible oils as a special case. Most probably such statements will be false. So here the correct answer is option A because only the first statement is correct. Know that India is one of the major oil seeds grower, while at the same time, India is also one of the major importers of edible oils. One of the recent initiative taken by Government of India with respect to edible oils is that India has modified its import policy on refined palm oil and refined palm olein from free import to restricted import. Now let's move on to next question. Now this question is with reference to Sammakka Sarakka Jatra. With reference to India's culture and tradition, what is Sammakka Sarakka Jatra? It's a tribal festival of Koya tribes in Telangana. The correct answer for this question is option A. It's a tribal festival of Koya tribes in Telangana who commemorate the fight of a mother and daughter against the rulers of Kakatiya dynasty, fighting against an unjust law wherein the rulers has forced the tribal communities to pay taxes. Sammakka is the mother, Sarakka or Saralamma is the daughter. know that it is the state festival of Telangana. Now, if you see its option C, it states it is a tribal festival of the Gond tribes in Jharkhand. Now, recently, an important festival celebrated by Gond tribes in the state of Telangana in Adilabad district was in news. This festival was called as Nagoba Jatra. Now, come to the last statement. It is an ancient martial arts tradition in Kerala. The correct answer pertaining to this statement would be Kalaripayattu. So, the correct answer for this question is option A. Now, this question is with reference to CERTIN or Indian Computer Emergency Response Team. Two statements are given. They are asking which of the above statements are correct. First statement, it is the national nodal agency for responding to cyber security incidents. Now, this statement is correct. Eliminate option B and option D. Now, second statement, it is functioning under Ministry of Home Affairs, which is incorrect because it functions under Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology. It is operational since the year 2004. Now, know that if the question is with reference to National Critical Information Infrastructure Protection Center, then you should know that this center is designated as National Nodal Agency with respect to Critical Information Infrastructure Protection. Generally, with respect to responding to cybersecurity incidents, the National Nodal Agency is Computer Emergency Response Team under MeitY. Correct answer for this question is option A, one only. Now, this question is with reference to decline in population of leopards in India. In 2014, there was a question that asked, other than poaching, what are the possible reasons for the decline in the population of Ganges River dolphins? In the same line, they have given a question here. They're asking, what are the possible reasons for the decline in population of leopards in India? They're saying man-animal conflict, poaching, less availability of prey, habitat loss. Recently, we are discussing several articles, research articles, which have mentioned that there is a significant decline to the tune of around 75% to 90% in the population of leopards in the Indian subcontinent. And most of the reasons for the decline are human-induced. See, man-animal conflict is one of the reasons for the decline of population of leopards. Man-animal conflict also leads to significant loss of habitat for leopards, and they are saying that in Asia itself, there is around 83% to 87% of drop in the geographical range of leopards over the last 120 to 200 years. So both first point and fourth point will be there. Now, coming to poaching, it is also there because of illegal activities of poaching on leopards for their fur and also for their bones. Third point, the less availability of prey is also there. That is also one of the reasons for the declining population of leopards. So the correct answer for this question is option D, 1, 2, 3 and 4. With this, we come to the end of today's The Hindu News Analysis. If you like the video, click the like button, suggest to your friends, comment and subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates and content on civil service exam preparation. We will meet you tomorrow.